The process of creation of the universe is a very elaborate process. And all what we know is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created everything from a single point, which they call the initial singularity. And we came to understand this from the fact that it has been proved that our universe is steadily expanding. And if we go back against time, this expansion will coalesce. Everything in that universe will come together into a tiny little point that almost comes to nothing, nothingness, you see. And from this, they say the universe was created by the Big Bang. And this point exploded and of course changed into a cloud of smoke. And from that smoke, Allah has created the earth and everything in that universe. The stars, the galaxies, the constellations, the moons, the planets, everything was created from that smoke. And we believe in that because in the Quran, we have clear-cut notions for the creation from smoke, the fact that the universe is expanding, the fact that the universe was an initial singularity which Allah has broken asunder. We read, ثُمَّ اسْتَوَى إِلَى السَّمَاءِ وَهِيَ دُخَانٌ or before that, وَالسَّمَاءَ بَنَيْنَاهَا بِأَيْدٍ وَإِنَّا لَمُسِعُونَ and the firmament we have built with might, and verily who have made it that vast is will be steadily expanding it. And the expansion of the universe was discovered at the beginning of the 20th century. For the Quran to spell it out 14 centuries ago is a miracle by itself. Then we read, ثُمَّ اسْتَوَى إِلَى السَّمَاءِ وَهِيَ دُخَانٌ. Then Allah established himself in a way that suits his glory on the firmament when it was all in as smoke. And from that smoke, he has created the earth and everything else. ثُمَّ اسْتَوَى إِلَى السَّمَاءِ وَهِيَ دُخَانٌ فَقَالَ لَهَا وَلِلْأَرْضِ إِتِيَا طَوْعًا أَوْ كَرْهًا قَالَتَا أَتَيْنَا طَاعِينَ. Allah ordered things be and it was. And then we read, أَوَلَمْ يَرَى الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا أَنَّ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضَ كَانَتَا رَتْقًا فَفَتَقْنَاهُمَا وَجَعَلْنَا مِنَ الْمَاءِ كُلَّ شَيْءٍ حَيٍّ. Having the unbeliever seen that both the firmament and the earth were a single entity, and then we broke them asunder. So we believe in the Big Bang theory or something like it, because this is very clearly spelled out in the glorious Quran.
Okay, Professor, discussing the Big Bang theory. So those non-believers don't think that what was before the Big Bang explosion, because sure there was a force that caused this explosion.
Yes. You see, as I said before this episode, a very eminent scholar in our time, Stephen Hawking, said that now we understand that this universe came by an explosion. And he said it is in the inner nature of explosions to scatter things randomly and chaotically. And said for an explosion to build a universe with definite distances, masses, volumes, speed of rotation, this must be very well planned before.
Yes.
And as I said in the previous half of this episode, very eminent scientists in the area of astronomy today say that this vast, immense, orderly universe must have a point of reference outside it. And that point of reference is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this point of reference must be completely different from the creation. Neither space nor time can shape his identity, neither matter nor energy. No, neither space nor time can delimit his identity, and neither matter and energy can shape that identity.
So basically, Dr. Zaghloul, it's the force of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is the main cause.
Indeed. Allah is governing that universe and governing every bit in it, every movement in it, every spin in it. Allah is governing it.
So still, those who are unbelieved or don't believe in God, those are admit this fact?
You see, there is a big difference between knowledge and guidance. You may have knowledge, but if you don't have the guidance, it will never lead you anywhere. We have very many eminent scholars in the West who are agnostics or atheists or unbelievers, you see. And we as Muslims did not play our role properly in bringing to their notice or their attention to these scientific notions in the glorious Quran. And I do hope that such programs can reach the notice of many non-believers, and Allah, may Allah give them guidance, inshallah.
Inshallah.
Inshallah. Okay, moving to you, Abdurrahman.
Given the fact that there is a lack of gravity in space, I wonder what keeps a star in its place or what keeps it in its orbit.
Can you raise your voice a little bit? Yeah.
So the question is the position of the stars with no gravity. What maintains the positions and the sequence?
No, actually, gravity is one of the forces that controls the relationship between these bodies, you see. Gravity is, of course, we have four main forces in the universe. The weak nuclear force that binds elementary particles in the nuclei of elements. We have this is a strong nuclear force. Then we have the weak nuclear force that binds electrons to the nucleus. We have the electromagnetic force that binds atoms together in a molecule and in compounds in general. And then we have the gravity that binds these heavenly bodies together. And without these forces, this universe would collapse.
So there is gravity in space.
There is gravity, yes, yes.
And what causes gravity? Do we have a core for universe that pulls everything around it?
Wallahi, nobody knows exactly what creates gravity. It's a power which Allah has placed in that universe. Because without this power, this universe could not stand.
Okay, I have a little question.
Yes.
Does every star have to have a planet or a galaxy or?
You see, every star has got satellites like our sun. Our sun has got planets, moons, meteors, meteorites, comets, and you name it, you see. Within our own solar system, you see. So we assume that every star has got its own satellites in exactly the same way our sun has got its own satellites.
Okay. Any further questions before we move to the second verse?
Another small question. What makes a star a star? Is it the composition, the structure, or the size?
Stars are mainly composed of clouds of smoke. And there are vertigos that would created by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala within smoke cloud, and as a result of the tremendous pressure created within the cloud, the process of nuclear fusion will start. And once you start a process of nuclear fusion in a gaseous body, it becomes a star.
Okay, let's now move to the second verse and yes. Second ayah, وَسَمَاءَ وَالطَّرْقِ. The importance of this ayah and why is it there is so much emphasis on al-tariq.
وَالسَّمَاءِ وَالطَّارِقُ وَمَا أَدْرَاكَ مَا الطَّارِقُ النَّجْمُ الثَّاقِبُ.
By the heaven and at Tariq. And what will explain to you what is at Tariq? It is the star of piercing brightness.
You see, again, this is a form of an oath by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And as I said earlier, Allah is above giving an oath to us. Who are we that Allah would give us an oath? But when a Quranic verse comes in the context of an oath, this is a way of directing our attention to the importance of the matter by which the oath is given.
Yes.
You human beings, look at this matter because it's very important for your existence. So when Allah gives an oath by as-sama', the firmament, of course, if we look into the firmament, we can see a beautiful illustration of the might, knowledge, wisdom, and power of the Creator. I'm not going into that. So as-sama', or the firmament, is worthy of giving an oath by, to direct our attention to its greatness and its importance, its vastness and its orderly arrangement. What tariq, you see, and then the address goes to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وَمَا أَدْرَكَ مَا الطَّارِقِ النَّجْمُ الثَّاقِبِ. How could you know a tariq? It is the piercing star. What's a piercing star? Early commentators of the Quran, they said, it's every star. They said it's every star. But the context actually denies that. It must be a very special star so that Allah would name it At-Tariq. Only very recently we came to realize that stars have got a history of development, like any existing being. They are born, they have a baby stage, a youthful stage, an old age stage, and a moment of dying out. And if you get what we call a normal sequence star, like the sun, it will die out to what we call a red giant. But we have stars much greater in mass than the sun, 10 times the mass of the sun, or 15 times the mass of the sun. These are called supergiants. When you get a supergiant, it will die out as what we call supernova. And the supernova, it's a huge explosion. And as a result of that explosion, matter is condensed at the core of the supernova to a density beyond human imagination. The first stage of this condensation presses matter against each other so that it will change everything into neutrons. And we call this a neutron star. If you press the electrons in the orbit of a nucleus to reach the nucleus, you change everything into neutrality. Yes. We call this a neutron star. The neutron star is a small star. It has got a dimension of 18 to 20 kilometers, not more than that. But it has got a density of 1 billion tons for a cubic centimeter. 1 billion tons, 1,000 million tons for a cubic centimeter. If 1 centimeter of that star would fall on the Earth, would destroy the Earth completely. Completely destroy the Earth. So because of this high density, a neutron star revolves around its own axis at a very high speed. And of course, because of its nature, it radiates radio waves. And these radio waves come and knock the atmosphere of the Earth in exactly the same way somebody would be knocking at the door of wood or of steel, whatever you call it. And that's why Allah called it At-Tariq. Yeah. Taraqa in Arabic means knocked, you see. Al-Matraqa, something that you knock by, you see. So At-Tariq is translated the knocking star. The knocking star is a unique star because it revolves around its own axis 30 times a second, radiating immense quantity of radio waves. And these radio waves can penetrate the universe.
These are new discoveries to the science.
New discovery. This was known in the later part of the 1970s, later part of the 20th century, 1980s. Yes. And for the Quran to spell that out 14 centuries ago is a living testimony to every rational person.
I'd love
that
to,
this cannot be the work of man.
This is a very beautiful statement, and I'd love to end it to end the edition with this statement. Professor Zaghloul Naggar, I really thank you very much for being here with us in this edition. And also thank our guest Zabihullah and Abdulrahman Ismail for being here with us. And with this, we come to the end of this edition of Quran and Science. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
TV strives to bring you, our viewers, the best in Islamic programming. Please send your comments and suggestions to feedback@hoda.com.